So welcome everybody to the Workday 33 financials release webinar. I'm very happy to welcome you all to this webinar. The objective of today, and I will go through the slides, but the objective of today is to present to you some of the new features present in Workday financials. I know in this webinar we have some existing Workday customers and some potential new to Workday people. So I will try and be as clear and as using, say, not the Workday terminology as much as I can. So thanks for holding on. So first of all, I'm just going to. Why is it not switching around? So first of all, I'm going to present myself. My name is Dawson Clace. I'm working at HRPuff for 3 years now. I'm a Workday Financial Certified Consultant, as well as Workday Procurement and Expenses. Don't know. Why is it not working? Sorry, guys. There's something I'm having trouble with. So the objective of today is to provide you with a clear understanding of the upcoming changes in Workday 33, to enable you to consider what's applicable to your company and where HRPath can assist you. No questions will be entertained during the presentation. So my recommendation would be just to note down your questions as we go along and share them with us by email after the session, and it'll be more simple for me to answer the question whilst staying within the time of this webinar, because there's a lot of new features and 1 hour is quite short just to go through all of these new features. So a couple of modules that we're going to cover today. We're going to start with expenses, banking and cash management, budget, business assets, sorry, customer contracts, financial accounting, procurement, supplier invoices, and tax. So just a quick notion on Workday 33. All of the features in the release are based on real life customer experiences. So as you might be aware of, Workday has what it's called the community. And within the community, existing customers can post their questions and their remarks to Workday on that community. And other customers can vote on it. And the brainstorms that have the most votes normally are the ones that Workday work on in priority to release for the new releases. So I just want to keep mentioning that this is really important, that if you have any features that you would like to see in the system, that you raise a Workday community post, and you will have a chance, hopefully, to have that new feature in one of the new releases in Workday. So, of course, the presentation is subject to a safe harbor statement. So please familiarize yourself with this safe harbor statement. I'm aware in this presentation that there are some people with only expenses and HCM, Workday HCM. So of course you can stay for the whole of the presentation if you'd like to. But I'm aware that, you know, if your modules that only interest you are expenses and HCM, then please feel free to drop off as well from the webinar after the expense module. So we'll start with expenses. We're not wasting too much of your time in that sense. So please feel to drop off or to stay if you'd like to see some of the new features on the financials in general. So just a quick update on Workday. There are two types of new release available. The first ones are opt-in features, which means that you have to do extra configuration in the system in order to have that new feature available. Sometimes it can be a very just, you know, just checking a tick box or updating a new field. And sometimes it can be a little bit more complex where you really have to set up a new business process or set up some specific security features in order to have that feature available. And the second type of feature is automatically available features. And for those types of features, you don't need to do anything. This will be automatically available in your production tenant from the release date of that feature. So let's start with expenses. Expenses have quite some new features this year. And the first one that we're going to go over is the maximum daily amount for expense items. So with Workday 33, now you can configure a maximum daily amount on expense items to monitor and control the spending on expenses. So on an expense item, you can select there's a new field called the maximum daily amount field, and you can then either link it to an expense rate table or you can enter a maximum daily amount for that item. So for example, you can see that this is an expense item of taxi, and previously we didn't have the field called maximum daily amount. We only had maximum line amount. So the difference between that is that for the maximum daily amount, if you have multiple lines on your expense report of taxi, it will sum those lines in order to have a maximum daily amount. So as you can see, that maximum daily amount can be used with a fixed or maximum expense amount. You can also always allow overage at the bottom here of your screen. To be able for your employees to be able to still post more than the maximum amount. The impact of that is that they will receive a validation message, a little error, not an error message, but a warning message when they're about to submit their expense report that tells them that they are exceeding the limit, maximum daily amount limit. The manager as well of that employee will also receive that alert message, so he can also action on that. So as you can see, you can also link that maximum daily amount to an expense rate table. For example, you have a maximum daily amount on a taxi based by location. So depending on which country you take your taxi in, you will have a different amount or in a different currency. And that's so that can be set up and that can be linked to your maximum daily amount. So that's one of the new features on expenses, which is quite interesting in my opinion, in order to be able to control spending on a day-to-day basis. The second feature is that Workday has now revamped a little bit the per diem feature. You can now define fixed hourly amounts on expense rate table. Previously, you could not have fixed hourly amounts. You could only have daily per diems, so day-to-day per diems based on an expense rate table. Now you can really configure by hour, and this makes it easier and faster to configure tables and also to improve the readability. So that's one of the new features. So as you can see, it's linked to your expense rate table. There's two new fields now available on that expense rate table. The first one is called attribute to evaluate. And there you would need to specify to select the number of hours option. And on the attribute to multiply, which is also a new field, you also have to select the number of hours option. And when you are then creating your expense rate table, you can put an amount per hour of your per diem depending on a location, for example. So I am going I'm having some expenses and I have a per diem when I'm traveling. Depending on which country I'm traveling, my per diem rate could be different, and it could be different in terms of the amount per hour, as previously we only had the possibility to have a different amount per day. So I hope that's clear. I think it's a very useful new tool to be able to reflect in some countries the way that they are processing per diems. I know for a fact that in Europe, depending on the country, you have very different ways of calculating per diems. So this should help set up these per diems in a more efficient and easy to maintain manner. And the third feature on expenses is, I'd say, probably the most important feature on expenses so far. And I'm sure that a lot of you will have some questions on this if you have expenses, and if you haven't already had that new feature enabled. So it's the expense report user interface enhancement. So this was something started in Workday 32, where Workday, was already revamping the interface of the expense report performance and functionality. But now with Workday 33, they have made it automatically available for all existing customers. Therefore, if you haven't set that up in Workday 32, you might see a slight change in your next on Workday 33 production tenant. This is also available on all of your Workday app on your mobile devices, so Android, iPad, and iPhone, just for a consistency of interface. So as I said, it was an opt-in for Workday 32 release, but it's automatically enabled with Workday 33. So please don't hesitate to contact us if you have any questions around this, if you haven't set this up in Workday 32. So there are quite some new fields linked to this interface. The first one is on your dashboard, on your employee dashboard. You now have the edit expense report action at the top of your screen. This was not present previously. It was not present previously because you can only edit once the report was already saved as a draft. And now you can edit it even if you've created them previously. And also at the bottom of the dashboard, you now see the most recent expense reports, even if they are in a draft or in an approved mode. So that's one of the features that you didn't have previously, is that you had to access the find my expense reports to be able to see the list of your expense reports. Now you have them available on your dashboard. One of the new features as well is on the expense report header level. You now have a memo field available on the expense report header. And the impact of that memo field is that the memo that you enter is carried over to the next step of the expense report process. So for example, in the example here shown, the memo that you type for your expense report will be given to the name of your expense report after the expense report number. So for example, if in memo I wrote down demo expense report, when I'm creating my expense report, after the expense report number, that title is given to your expense report. So that's pretty good to be able to be aware of, have a text or a description linked to your expense report to make it easier for people to find their expense reports later on and to edit them. So the tabs are now processed in independent tabs. So for example, you have the header level, the attachment level, and the expense line level, and you can edit them independently to one another. That wasn't the case before. In the previous Workday 32, in the previous interface, once you had created your header level, of your expense report, you could not go back on it, and you were obliged to save as and to get out of the expense report mode and to edit it again. In this case, you can switch from header to expense line in an easier way. And also, you can, for example, if you edit the memo on the header level after you've filled in your expense lines, for example, it will still update the name of your expense report. So, a pretty good functionality, in my opinion. Also, I think that's some of the questions that I've seen as well in the past, is that depending on the expense item, some of the fields are now hidden in a dynamic way. For example, the field quantity and the per unit amount, which was present on all expense items in the past, now can be hidden for specific expense items. So, for example, in this case, you have office supplies has a quantity and a per unit amount, but for example, taxi, trains and shuttles don't have quantity or don't have per unit amounts. So that's new. Previously, we used to have quantity and per unit amounts on all expense items. It didn't matter if you had configured and if it needed a quantity or not, it was present and we couldn't hide it. Now we can hide it. So that's pretty good. Also, the multi-currency setup is now automatically available. Previously, you had to tick a checkbox on the expense header level to be able to enable multi-currency. Now it's automatically present if you have multi-currency set up in your system. And so it's easier for the user and it's easier for managers to review that now. One of the most also, I think, interesting features of this new interface is the fact that you are now, your custom validations or your error messages are linked specifically to your lines, to your expense report lines. So previously it was specific to your expense report in general, and you would have multiple errors depending on multiple on the errors that you had in your report. Now it's on a line-to-line basis. It makes it easier for the user to be aware as to which expense lines have an error and what's the specific error linked to that line. So it makes it easier for them to address those errors. And also those errors pop up when you add a new expense report line. Whilst previously the errors were popping up only when you were submitting the expense report, so it makes it easier once again to correct those errors, make sure that your expense report is correct. And then one of the new features on the credit cards side is that there's a new merchant column in the credit card transactions and the quick expense tabs. So previously, when we were uploading the credit card transactions, the merchant name was not present. Now it is, and it makes it clearer as to what type of credit card expense it is. And also that merchant column is going to be taken over into your expense report line on the right of your expense report. And that's useful. So the merchant is already populated and the employee doesn't have to populate it themselves. So that helps to avoid mistakes. Okay, so I'll keep going. So that was for expenses. If you, of course, are not interested in seeing the rest of the financials releases, please feel free to drop off. For those who are interested in the financials features, please stay on. We start with the banking new releases. So the first new release on banking is line company on ad hoc bank transaction templates. So with Workday 33, you can now generate intercompany ad hoc bank transactions when you are using a template. So The feature includes the possibility to add a company on a line of the ad hoc bank transaction, which was previously not available. And that can help you to make sure that your ad hoc bank transactions are, generate or intercompany correctly. You can also add that on a template, which makes it easier for you to reuse those templates in the future with the right companies at the line level. The second feature is, Workday are moving from bank reconciliation rule sets to matching rule sets. So it's just a change in the tasks that they are using. And this will be deprecated in Workday 35, so in a year's time. And to prepare existing customers that have these bank reconciliation rule sets to make the switch, you are now able to copy those rule sets into matching rule sets. So this helps to streamline the transition really from reconciliation rules to matching rules. And so if you are using automatic bank reconciliation feature within Workday, this could be the time to review those rules, in my opinion, and to transform them into matching rules, so that when Workday 35 comes along, you are not surprised that and you have been, those ad hoc bank automatic bank reconciliation rules still work as you are expecting them to work. And the third one is an automatically available feature. It's the Workday has added a new field on the ad hoc bank transactions, and the new field is called external references. And with this update, you can now add external references on ad hoc business transactions. So it was not there previously. That's the first thing that I want to tell you. It wasn't there previously. And the advantages of this is that you can now put in a free text field with, for example, the reference of a specific transaction. So it's easier for you to do reconciliation from external systems, for example. Okay, so one of the new features on budgets, and there is one major one and only one major one on budget, is that now you can, with Workday 33, you can now plan, control, and report on financial plans using company hierarchies. That was not previously available, and it's one of the new features of Workday trying to develop their budget module to make it easier for companies that have company hierarchies and many subsidiaries to be able to process budgets in an efficient way. So that's one of the new releases, and that was previously not available. Previously, you had to do your budget on a company-to-company level. Okay, business assets is the next module. And the main new feature there is that Workday continues to enhance your ability to preview the depreciation schedule for an asset. And they are adding new fields in order to be able to support more easily the accumulated depreciation and historical bonus depreciation amounts at the beginning of the fiscal year. So there should be some possibility to add the accumulated depreciation and the historical depreciation before the registration of your assets, which was previously not the case, as Workday would make the calculation himself on the accumulated depreciation. There's a field that will enable you to reference your accumulated depreciation. That should help to avoid some of the errors and to add flexibility on your registration of existing assets. Those fields are also available for use in a new report called Preview Asset Depreciation Report. And they should also be available if you are customizing assets report. They should be available there as well for you to use in your reporting. Okay, some of the new features on customer contracts. So the first new feature on customer contract is that Workday 33 is adding a bit of flexibility to the customer contract reporting functionality. It's increasing the number of reports, standard reports actually, that's already existing in Workday that you can now copy and edit to create your own custom reports out of. So that's one of the new features, which I think is going to be very useful, is that sometimes Workday is very, is not really flexible on what type of reports you can copy and customize. And I think on, especially on customer contracts, there's a lot of standard reports that, are fixed in stone. They have now changed that and are giving you then the opportunity to create your own custom reports out of existing reports. So I think that's going to be very useful for those who want to report on customer contracts. The second new feature is around transfer pricing for multi-currency. So with Workday 33, the customer contracts have now been updated, improved, so transfer pricing can be done in multiple currencies between intercompany. So this feature will be automatically available, and it's something to look into. I think it's going to be a nice new release as well. And thirdly, you can now create and customize your own customer contract templates. So that makes it easier for you to, if you have customer contracts that are similar and that keep coming in the same with the same information, you can now create a template that you can reuse all the time to create your contracts. So that should make it easier to create contracts in the first place, and it should be easier for you to maintain as well, and to be able to use the same fields and values for your contracts. So I think that's pretty useful for customers that have repetitive customer contracts or customer contracts that every year are the same, or for similar types of clients. So that's going to be quite useful. Okay, let's have a look at the financial accounting. And the first feature is a very interesting feature, which is the possibility to reconcile cash operational transactions to cash ledger balances. So with Workday 33, it's now possible to efficiently reconcile cash operational transactions to cash ledger balances. So they are giving, Workday has created some new reports, some new reporting tools, and in order to enable you to reconcile if your bank account is now synchronized with your accounting system, and this report needs to be set up. But it's in my opinion a very useful new reporting tool, and it eliminates the need to do the reconciliation with your bank accounts outside of Workday, which was previously the case. So I'm just going to show you what that new report looks like. It's called Find Cash to Bank Reconciliation Initial Balances. And with that new report, you can see that within the same ledger account, which is 1,000 cash, you now have the possibility to find out to which bank account, what amount per bank account is included in that ledger account. So it gives you more granularity on your ledger account, on your cash ledger account, and it helps you to reconcile to make sure that you have the right amounts per bank account. So it also compares the operational cash balances and the ledger cash balances, so highlighting any difference. And it also shows if your operational cash balances or activities are in error, as well as future period cash activities in company currency. So as you can see on the screen, you now have the differences in terms of if there are differences between what's expected in your ledger account and what you actually had in your bank account, and you can action on those differences and making sure that you avoid errors with your cash accounts. And here you have another report, which is linked to your cash to bank reconciliation activities. So what activities still have to be processed, and what type of bank statement, what type of transaction it was, what type of operational transaction, in which ledger account those went originally, what's the original journal. So you get more and more information as on the ability to reconcile your cash operational transaction to your cash ledger account. So I think those reports are going to be very useful to be able to reconcile cash operational transactions to cash ledger account, which was not the case previously and had to be done outside of Workday. Okay, so now let's move to procurement. I'm aware also that maybe some of you don't have procurement, but once we get through procurement, we're going to have a look at supplier invoices and taxes. So please stick around for that. So with procurement, the first new feature is the ability to order from connections on supplier contracts. So now you have a new field on supplier contracts in Workday 33, where you can indicate the address or the shipping information on your procurement transactions. So this helps you to ensure that purchase orders are issued to the correct supplier based on what you're ordering and from whom. And this is based out of the supplier contracts and follows all the way through the procurement process. So once an order from connection is set up on the supplier contract, it will be present on your purchase order, it will be present on your receipting, and it will be present on your invoice. And the second new feature is the exclude incomplete receipts from purchase orders. So with Workday 33, you can now prevent quantities and amounts on draft or in progress receipts from displaying on your purchase orders. So previously, if you were creating a receipt, and even if that receipt was not approved, if it was in draft or in progress, that receipt would be linked to your purchase order. Now, the Workday gives you the possibility to remove those incomplete receipts from your purchase orders. So once you have now your purchase orders, you can make sure that only your purchase orders, your purchase orders will only include your approved and completed receipts. So that helps in principle to avoid the errors on receipts, reduce over receiving, and avoid risks in general in the procurement process. Another feature is the enable price updates for purchase order lines with invoice. So Workday 33 gives you a bit more flexibility on the purchase orders lines when your invoice is in draft or triggers a match exception. So if you have an invoice in draft or in a match exception, and you realize that actually the unit cost or on the purchase order was wrong, you can now go back on your purchase order and correct that unit cost. And that should, without having to cancel the supplier invoice or override the match exception. So previously, you had to cancel the invoice and or the match exception, go back all the way to your purchase order, correct your purchase order, go back through the whole process and resubmit an invoice or resubmit the match exception in order for that to be processed correctly. And now Workday gives you a bit more flexibility which is a good thing, in my opinion. And it then enables you to edit your purchase order lines, even if you have an invoice in draft or you have a match exception. That just helps to smoothen and to for the flow of the procurement flow, sorry, to be easier to process. Another new feature is the ability to close purchase order lines for invoicing. I think that's a really new, good new feature. So with Workday 33, it enables you to close individual purchase order lines for invoicing to avoid the receipt accruals that you don't want to invoice or that you have already invoiced, for example. So it enables you to take advantage of the supplier discounts and to avoid accruals or over received amounts by closing the lines for goods or service you didn't order. So let me just show you how it looks. So now you can see on the screen you have a purchase order. On the related action of your purchase order, you have now a new a new action called close lines, as you can see. Once you close the lines, you go into the goods or service line of your purchase order, and you can select which lines you want to close for invoicing. So you could close one line, for example, or you could close multiple lines. Each time that you do close the lines, you have to give a reason as to why you are closing that line. So that's the first thing. And once a line is closed, it is visible in its status. So you will see a status of the line will be closed. There will be a closed reason. There will be a closed date, and there will be a closed by. So you are aware as to who closed the line, at what date, and for what reason. And you're going to tell me, well, okay, that's good, but hopefully you can reopen the lines in case you make that was a mistake. And Workday gives you the flexibility for that. And the good news is that that's the case. So if a mistake was made, or if a purchase order has closed lines, once again, a new action is available from the related action of your purchase order, and it's at the bottom of the action, and it's called reopen lines. And the reopen lines option enables you to reopen some or all of the lines that you closed previously, and they return to their previous status, which means there's no status open. It's a blank status. The only status that pops up is when the line is closed, but it's still useful in case an error was made or in case for flexibility during the procurement process. Okay, so we're back now with supplier invoices. So one of the new features on supplier invoices, and there's not that many this year, which is, I guess it's a good thing because in general, I think supplier invoice process is working quite well at the moment. But there is something linked to allocation templates on supplier invoices. So with Workday 33, you can create a Worktag split allocation templates that you can use on your supplier invoices and adjustments. So there's a new field on your supplier invoice, which is called Worktag split allocation. And you can set up a template for this new field. And the objective of this template is to split line by amount and then select specific work tags for each line split based on the template definition. So this enables you to set up allocation percentages for splitting invoice lines in advance, increasing transaction accuracy and reducing manual processing. So this is it's linked between allocation and supplier invoices. And we go into our final module of today's presentation, which is tax. So the first new feature on tax side is the gapless document sequence numbers by statutory invoice type. So that doesn't, you know, ring a bell to a lot of people, but because of the name, I think. But the what Workday is trying to do is it's trying to improve the way the sequence numbering of its customer invoices and supplier invoices by statutory invoice type. So I think in a lot of different countries, there's a lot of different statutory requirements in the way that the sequence numbering of invoices needs to be done. Depending on countries, customer and supplier invoices should have a numbering that follows the same, or sorry, follows the same order. And in some countries, you have more flexibility where your customer sequence number, customer invoice sequence number can be different to your supplier invoice sequence number. So the objective of this new feature is to be able to just give more flexibility to customers depending on the country, and it helps you to comply with transaction tax reporting requirements. Yeah, that's the main objective of this feature. So here we have a look at this new feature. So you have now a new task called Create Invoice Sequence Generator Rule Configuration. I agree that the name is quite long. It's not really super clear, but at least it gives you the ability to define and to be flexible and to define whatever your sequence format should be based on supplier or customer invoices. So first of all, you can select the invoice type the configuration applies to, so customer or supplier invoices. You can give the lifespan of the sequence generator, so it can be based of out of calendar year, ledger period, or ledger year. And from then you can create you have the flexibility to create your own sequence format with you know, this is how it is currently. So the number of numbers that you need, what's the name, how it's supposed to present itself, and you can differentiate depending on the country. You can have this specific format. For example, in this case, we have a different format for China if it's non-deductible purchase invoices, or if it's a simplified purchase orders, or if it's a red letter purchase order. So depending on the country, you can have different types of sequence formats, or you could just have as it is at the moment, which is a unique ID for supplier invoices and for customer invoices. Okay, so that's the new feature. Of course, has to be configured for each of the companies where it should be used. So as you can see on the edit company ID definitions, you now have a new tab called gapless document sequence setting, and you can enable this option for customer invoices, for supplier invoices, or for one or the other. And you can also, you know, have different sequence generators for, you know, supplier invoice adjustments, for example, for supplier invoices adjustments that increase, supplier invoices adjustment that decrease. So really, this new functionality is really in the Workday is keeping on going, trying to be more flexible in the way that they do the sequence generators and the sequence numbers, just to comply with the different statutory requirements of different countries all over the world. So this should help, definitely. Yeah, and then once the periods are opened, the generators can be found at the bottom of the page, and the lifespan is defined as the calendar year generators. If it's the calendar year, generators start with August and continue through the remainder of the calendar year. But of course, you have the possibility to do ledger accounts, ledger periods and ledger years. So there's more possibilities there. And after the invoice has been finalized and approved and the period closed, the number can then be found on the supplier or customer invoice. And this is also a number that can be used in reporting for all your reporting to be able to comply with the tax or the statutory requirements of your countries. Okay, so we went through the session quite well. I hope you enjoyed this webinar. I hope this was clear enough to you as to what are some of the new releases. There are still, I guess, a lot of questions on your side, and I'd be glad to answer those questions and to see how HR Path can help you if you need to set up some of those new modules within your current production tenants. So don't hesitate to send your questions to Juanita or myself. And you can also follow us, of course, on social media. And you have our address there in case you want to, and our phone number in case you want to have somebody directly on the phone. I hope please go ahead and ask any questions that you want, and hopefully I'll see you very soon and hear from you very soon. Thank you very much all for joining. I wish you a pleasant day and a pleasant week. And thank you all. Bye-bye now.